Hi, so my name is Billy, and I'm here to talk to you about making art with JavaScript. So a bit about myself before I start. I work as a designer at a company called Open Door. We buy, renovate, and sell homes in four cities: Phoenix, DFW, Atlanta, and Las Vegas. And also help organize a monthly meetup called WaffleJS in San Francisco. And this is my handle on Twitter, where I'll be tweeting out a link to my slides and afterwards. So it seems like every time I wake up, pop up my computer, go online, and there's a new JavaScript framework to look at, right? You know, there's Angular, React, Elm, Yarn. I don't know what half of these are, but I mean, these are really good because, you know, it gives us a lot of tools to work with. But at the same time, they all have a clear, defined purpose, a right way to use them and a wrong way to use them. And all these utilitarian frameworks make me want something more like when I first started programming, where things are more exploratory and open-ended with no clear utility in mind. And I think JavaScript is an incredible, flexible medium that's perfect for this. So it can be used towards this end and create art. Now, when I think of creating art with JavaScript, two artists come to mind, Josef Albers and Anni Albers. Now, these are artists from Germany who later immigrated to America. And they studied together at an influential design school called Bauhaus, which was in Berlin. Josef created works like this that are bold, graphic, and iconic. And he mostly worked in paint, glass, and paper. And Anni Albers, she created works like this. And she worked mostly in weavings, drawings, and wall hangings, and jewelry. Now, it's worth mentioning at this point that at the Bauhaus, she and all other women were formally barred from pursuing painting as a study, which is kind of ironic because the Bauhaus movement had some really radical ideas around art and design and its place in society, but it couldn't recognize or move past its own deep-seated prejudices. So these two, I think they're great candidates because their works mainly are concerned with color and pattern composition, and these are things that we could easily reproduce in JavaScript. Now, the first thing I like to reproduce is Josef Albers' most famous work called Homage to the Square. So Homage to the Square isn't just one thing. It's actually a collection of many, many things, hundreds of pieces. But there are notable visual patterns in all these works, obviously. So the most obvious one is where there are a series of three or four squares nested in one another. And less obviously, they tend to come in one of two flavors. Ones where the color palette is basically the same, so mostly yellows, mostly reds, mostly blues. And other ones where the color palette is more contrasting, so blues and yellows and reds and greens. So let's take these two things about composition and color and break them down even further to create our own images out of them. So let's start with something easy, the size of the squares. So the small square here is 40% of the 40% of the size of the overall canvas. And the following squares, they grow by 20% until they reach 100%. The second largest square is positioned 5% from the bottom of the canvas. And the succeeding squares, they go up by increments of 5 until they get to the center. Now, before we can go on any further, we should take a very, very quick color theory break, which is personally my favorite kind of break. And let's take all the hues in the world and display them out into a wheel like this. And if you want to learn more about stuff like this, you should watch Visnu's talk from HSL about HSL from JSConf Iceland. So if you were to take three samples from around the same point on this color wheel over here, you would get what's called an analogous palette. This is where the hues are roughly the same to one another. If you take three samples where they're roughly a third apart, you would get what's called a triad palette. So with those definitions in mind, you can consider these works analogous, because, you know, it's mostly reds, mostly yellows. They're basically the same. And these are triads-ish. Some are more complementary, some are less triads. So you can basically say that these are more contrasting than analogous color palettes. So let's move on to the code. So to generate these palettes, we'll be using a color system called HSL. Stands for hue, what hue it is, saturation, how intense the color is, and lightness, which is how light or dark the color is. And to generate an analogous palette, we first generate a random color. And we set the lightness to be on the lighter side, so between 60 and 90%. And then we create a second color of a similar hue where the lightness is much lower, so between 10 and 40%. So at this point, we've created the two ends of the spectrum that we'll be working with. We calculate the differences between these two ends in terms of H, S, and L, and then we create two equal steps between these. So something like this. Now we have our analogous color set. To create our triad color set, we want to create two analogous colors. And then we want to take the hue of the first color, subtract around 100 to create the triad hue, and then create two analogous colors based on that triad hue. Now we have our triad palette. So this is a demo of what it could possibly play out like. So you'll see that the analogous colors are very similar to one another. And the lightest or the darkest, they're not always at the center or at the very edges. So you get this nice, varied pattern. All right, it's pretty cool, right? So there's actually one more thing on top of this. Yeah, really nice. So Khan Academy has an article on Omosh the Square. And there's this really choice quote in there that says, stand back from this painting and look at the whole thing. Are the squares stacked up on top of each other like cutout pieces of construction paper? Or are they sinking underneath each other as if you're looking at a painting of a tunnel? Each painting explored the same basic question. Can artists create the appearance of three dimensions using only color relations? So Josef Albers, he explored this question in his medium of canvas and paint. Now it's up to us to explore this question even further in our medium of JavaScript. One of the many possible answers here is for the squares to react to the cursor as if the squares are following the cursor around. This means that the squares will rotate towards the cursor as well as move towards it along the x-axis and the y-axis. Now keep in mind here that to deepen the sense of space, the effect should be more pronounced on smaller squares. So for example, if a smaller square were to rotate by 10 degrees, a bigger square would rotate by 3 degrees. This makes the smaller squares seem closer to us in space and the bigger ones farther away. Now these are the functions that we'll use to rotate and translate the squares. For this rotation function here, the gist of it is that the smaller the square, the more it rotates, and the closer the cursor is to the edge of the composition, the more it'll rotate as well. And the same principles hold true for these translation functions for the x and y axis. And here's a live demo of what that looks like. So you can see here that the effect on the smaller squares are much more pronounced in terms of rotation and translation. And they seem more close to us because of that. And the opposite holds true for the bigger squares, where they seem farther away from us because they translate and rotate less. So the second piece I like to talk about is called Fox 2 by Anni Albers. Now, if you look at this pattern really closely, you'll see that it's just a bunch of right triangles, and they come in one of four rotations like so. So considering this, we can create a really simple function that generates a random number between 1 and 4. And based on that, we draw the corresponding triangle, which looks something like this. Now, the conundrum here is that we could create a single element for every single one of these triangles, but we would end up with 900 polygons. And this gets really unwieldy, and the DOM would get cumbersome and hard to work with. It also makes the rendering much harder for lower-end devices. Now, the solution here is to use a single element called SVG path and stitch the 900 triangles together into a single thing. Now, SVG paths are a way for us to draw complex shapes in code. So it comes in with these five operators. M for move to, so go from one point to another without actually drawing anything. L for line, draw a line between these two points. A for arc, draw a section of an oval between these two points. C for curve, draw an arbitrary Bezier curve between these two points. And Z for close paths, I don't know. It just basically means that if you have three points on a path, you want to close it off and then move on to a separate shape. Now here's an example of what that would look like in code. First we instantiate a variable called triangle path. This is where we'll be storing our SVG path instructions. We use the M operator to move to these coordinates over here, then the L operator to move to draw a line to the right, and then L again to draw a line down to the left. and then the Z operator to say that we're done drawing the shape and we want to move on to the next thing. We repeat this for every single one of our triangles and append to a single string. So that means that we have a single element that handles 900 shapes as opposed to 900 individual SVG polygon elements. Now let's get into the palette of the piece. So you can see here that it's fairly simple and analogous. And if you look at her larger body of work, you can see some really vibrant pieces here too. So with that knowledge, we'll create two palettes, one analogous, one complementary. And complementary means that it's about 180 degrees away on the color wheel. So examples of that would be red, green, and blue, and yellow. Here's a demo of how that plays out. Note that it generates a new pattern every single time. And we can use a similar technique that we use in Homage to the Square to create these analogous and complementary color palettes. Just one more time. So if you look at the work a little closer, you can see that there are two sets of right triangles. And the darker triangles seem to be in front, and then the lighter ones seem to be in the back. So it's as if the darker ones are casting a shadow, and the lighter triangles are the shadow somehow. And if you remember our sample from earlier, this is what the shadow would look like. Now keep in mind that we want to deepen this effect in our generative piece. So to do this, we want to make the shadows move in the opposite direction of a light source, because that's how it works in real life. So if the cool sun over here with the sunglasses moves to the right, the shadow moves to the left, and then moves to the left, the shadow moves to the right. Also note that the triangles are clipped at the edges, so it's as if you're appearing through a pair of windows into a room that has a bunch of other triangles in it for some reason. So with these two observations, we can make two statements. Pretend the house represents the windows and the ghost is just shadow. So the window should translate towards our cursor and the shadows should translate away from the cursor. And because the windows are closer to us in space, its translation effect should be much more pronounced, whereas the effect should be much more subdued for the shadows. The combination of these two things is going to create an interesting parallax effect. Here's a demo of what that looks like. With this interaction, note how the windows translate to reveal other parts of the triangle pattern that you couldn't quite see before. And at the same time, you can see the shadows translating away from the cursor as if the light source is moving around with the cursor. So the third and final piece is called Orchestra, also by Anni Albers, and this one is, it's really goth. And if you were to look at this, you can see that it's a grid of 23 by 25. And for each section of the grid, there are basically four different configurations of lines, where it goes from top left to bottom right, top right to bottom left, top right, sorry, to, top left to top right, and then nothing. So you can already see that this is fairly similar to how it works in Fox 2. So we can use a pretty similar function here that generates a random number between 1 through 4. And then we can generate a line based off that. And now let's talk about palette. The color palette here, it's pretty simple. It's pretty high in contrast. And it's high in contrast because the two colors that they're using, they have a really big difference in L. So the background is an L of 2%, and the foreground is an L of 91%. If you look at other similar works by her, you can see that some of them have lower contrast and have a more analogous color palette. And here you can see that the L values are more closely clustered around one another, giving it a more low contrast effect. And here's a demo of that. So you can see the three configurations of lines moving about like that. And note that they never cross to make an X, like in the original work. And they create this illusion of clusters of lines like veins on a leaf. But in reality, it's a simple grid. One more time. So we can use our imagination here and try to create a sense of space in this piece. And we can do this by putting each of these lines on a separate SVG group. So all the horizontal ones together, all the bottom left to top right ones together, and then this one together. Now, right now I'm gonna try to convey what rotation means, so stick with me here. So for each of these layers, we're gonna apply rotation along the X and Y axes. So to illustrate this, I'm gonna use a pug, a corgi, and a Shiba. And we can assume at this point that things closer to us will rotate along the X axis much more dramatically than things that are farther away. So it'll look more like this, where the pug gets all face scrunched up like it should, and then the Shiba is kind of basically intact. And the same thing applies for rotating along the Y axis as well, where the pug looks pretty upset and the Shiba is just chilling out. So now we know the closer the layer, the larger the effect. So this is what the idea would look like in code, where the foreground should rotate the most by 15 degrees, and the midground should rotate a bit less than that, so 90%, and the background even less, so 90% of 90%. We can use these values to create a simple linear scale for each of these layers, which gives us something like this. You can see here that the different kinds of lines are rotating and translating at different rates. It almost looks like the lines are floating in space, which is kind of trippy. Cool. So I hope this is a useful overview of the different ways we can use these practical technologies to make something strange and beautiful. JavaScript doesn't have to be used for utilitarian web applications. It can also be more freeform and exploratory, just like I showed you here. We can apply color theory with HSL. We can create generative compositions with SVG paths. And we can also create the illusion of depth with transforms. And if you enjoyed my talk, you should watch this one by Amy Chang from JSConf Iceland. It was a big inspiration for this talk. And finally, you can go to this link to see the demo and the source. And you can tweet me your questions over here, where I'll be also tweeting out a link to these slides. Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
So what you're saying is that the Albers invented vaporwave and goth, right?
Yeah, basically, yeah.
We're just sort of co-opting it, which is fine, because now we're sort of co-opting like the creation of fine art using JavaScript.
Goes both ways.
Yeah. So I had a project where I was teaching art history and recreating artwork using JavaScript. And the JavaScript developers thought it was cool. The artists thought I was like a total like shitlord. I guess like just like there are people in tech who like don't really care about art and think that there's no place for art like in code, there are artists who are sort of tired of like constantly now hearing about like the intersection of art and code. Mm-hmm. And so if someone were to go to you and say, like, why did you make this, which is what I would get all the time, like, what would you say to them?
I think I mostly made it because I originally wanted to be an art history major, and then my dad vetoed that pretty hard, pretty quick. So this is my act of rebelling, I guess.
That's basically it for me. I think that... You know, you were saying that you don't just have to use code to write like sort of like web applications. You can be more exploratory. But I see a lot of parallels in what we do making art with code being usable in more, I guess, like professional implementations of code. I don't know what the right word for that is. What are some things that you've learned in this process that you see yourself using like in, I guess, like the workplace, for example? Math, maybe?
Yeah, I use some math in work, I guess. Actually, this is a really dumb example, but I created a random color generator based off someone's ID, so every single person who writes a note in our little internal note-taking system has a different color to them. I did that. That was pretty fun.
Yeah, there you go. That's like Rick related. Yeah. That's cool. Have you read Josef Albers' Interaction of Color?
I have not. I'm really sorry.
It's okay. I really highly recommend it. I'm writing a version of it that's more tied to how much of a shit show colors in JavaScript are, because you're dealing with like HSL or RGB, and like I feel like just like the color wheel in the digital space is like seven dimensions, and four of which we haven't discovered yet. Was color your biggest struggle with creating these pieces, figuring that stuff out?
To me, the biggest struggle was, doing the interaction bits, where this actually works on mobile too, and trying to get the beta, gamma, and alpha device orientation events to fire off correctly, that was a total pain in the ass.
Oh, that's super rad. Yeah. I think when I'm holding my phone and I move it and I see something moving inside of it, like I've been doing a lot of stuff with A-frame, like, ooh, that like blows my mind. And it's just, and nowadays it's such a, I guess, like simplistic operation, but it's not simple. Like working with three dimensions in a digital space is still like incredibly tasking, especially when it comes to optimizing it for the web. But all those examples are super rad, and I look forward to seeing more artists and stuff from you and everyone else who's been inspired. So thank you.
All right, thank you.